Hi, my name is Elise Lovelock. I'm a singer, voice actor, and YouTuber. You probably primarily know me as the voice of Mommy Longlegs in the game Poppy Playtime Chapter 2 and the singing voice of Charlie in the Hazbin Hotel pilot by Vivzy Pop on YouTube. I absolutely love being here. It's really lovely that they keep having me back. It's just amazing to meet fans and just meet new people in general, especially after the last couple of years we've had. It's just so nice to be out again. I got started with voiceover because I began in the musical theatre realm. So I've done a lot of cabaret and Amdram and lots of other things. I was on Britain's Got Talent years ago, which thank God didn't air because that would have been the most embarrassing thing ever. So those are my roots. And then I started to get into voiceover primarily on YouTube because I've had a channel since I was like 16. And it just kind of went from there. Yeah, I started doing like fan dubs and stuff like that, doing my own audio edits. And yeah, it just turned into this. I think people fell in love with Hazbin because Viv has created such a rich and interesting world with so many amazing, colourful, dynamic characters that have such great personalities. You know, she's got such a fantastic imagination and art style, and I think that just really draws people to it. You know, people love nothing more than a character that they can just, you know, idolise and watch that's, you know, just entertaining. You know, she's so good at creating characters that are just so entertaining. And yeah, it was just a huge honour to be a part of it. What Charlie means to me, I mean, she's just such a lovely character. She's very positive and energetic. She just wants to be good and do right by everybody. She wants to help people, which, you know, is such a great, you know, part of any personality, to want to help people. And I think people relate to her because she's just very, also quite vulnerable. You know, she's quite open with her feelings. And I think that's a really important aspect in a character, to make them relatable like that. And also the fact that she's basically a princess, which is amazing. That's what I love about her as well. She's kind of like the princess, Disney princess of my dreams, you know, that so it's amazing to give her a singing voice. Yeah, she's just the cutest. She's just a little cinnamon roll. I love her.
A little Luciferian body.
Yeah,
and obviously, the songs, particularly from the pilot, mean so much to people, and everyone has their favourites. I'm curious, is there one that means the most to you, and do you have any particular special memories from recording those?
Yeah, I mean, I love both the songs. They're both very different, which is what's really cool about them. One of them is very kind of slow and emotional. The other one is very energetic and, you know, lots of words. It was funny recording the second song, which is the energetic one, because I did so many takes and it was like one of the hardest songs I've ever done in my life. And then the first one, the slow one, I actually did that all in one take. So that was like, I really put like a lot of my own feelings into that, and it's really nice when people come up to me and they tell me that they relate to it and that they really feel the emotion in it. So that's just really, really nice to hear. And yeah, Parry Grip, who wrote both the songs, like, is such an amazing songwriter, and they're both just really great songs. I'm just really glad that I got to sing them.
Fans were so excited that we were going to get a series and that it was going to be produced by a big TV company and all of that. But I think they were obviously a little bit surprised and a bit dismayed that a lot of the original VA talent wasn't going to be returning. I guess, do you have any particular feelings about that? And can you talk about, to the extent you can, why so many of the original voice cast seemingly haven't stayed with the project?
Yeah, I mean, it's sad, but it's very common for a project that starts off in the pilot stage to change completely from its initial development. And obviously, like, you know, if Vivian's vision means that bringing in a new cast of people, then that's, you know, it's her creation. We all respect that. You know, we've absolutely loved working on it. We've loved, you know, spending time with each other. You know, I got to meet everybody a few years back in LA, and it was just lovely to share that experience with everyone. So yeah, you know, I'm sad not to be returning, but at the same time, you know, it's a bit different for me. Like, I'm in the UK, I was recording remotely, all the other casts were in the US, so I kind of suspected that even if everybody else got brought back, it might be a bit more difficult for me, because when a project goes into those kind of, you know, bigger stages, things start to become a bit more complicated. But at the end of the day, you know, that's her vision. I totally respect that, and I'm so grateful for all the happy times that being part of the project has brought me. So I, you know, I've got nothing but positive things to say.
I mean, do you think the fact that you and Jill originally shared it, it's relatively uncommon, I guess, for the singing and speaking parts of a character to be divided. Do you think that was maybe a natural thing, that when they were casting for the series, they were going to have to find someone who was going to effectively do both?
Yeah, I mean, I think that's another reason why they probably wanted to find somebody moving forward who could do both. And, you know, like I said, it's her vision. You know, she might have had somebody in mind. She might have wanted to look for a fresh voice. Who knows? It was amazing to share the role with Jill. I mean, it kind of harkens back to the old Disney Renaissance days where they used to have an actor voice one character and then get like a Broadway singer to do the singing voice, which, you know, would go together really seamlessly. And I just tried to match Jill as closely as possible. I mean, Jill's voice is so lovely. You know, it's just great that she, you know, brought so much life to the character, and I feel really honored to have, you know, tried to match her and share the character with her.
One of the biggest reasons that it's exploded in kind of pop cultural awareness, despite only being on YouTube and only so far being the pilot, is because of the way people have celebrated the show with cosplay and memes. Do you have favorite Hazbin memes?
I don't think I've seen too many memes, but I mean, I have seen some amazing artwork, amazing cosplays. You know, it's got a very passionate fandom, which is always so lovely to see. And people are very like into the lore of the hell lore that, you know, Viv has created. It's just lovely to see something that has such a positive reception, and it's just really lovely to be part of something like that. And yeah, the fans are just amazing. I've met, you know, so many of them in both like the US and the UK so far. I hope to meet more, and I'm just, yeah, really grateful to be along on the Hazbin journey, you know.
Do you think as well that the very, very strong LGBT themes and representation in Hazbin is part of the success of the show?
Yeah, absolutely. I think the LGBTQ plus representation in Hazbin is really good. You know, it's wonderful to have characters from such a dynamic show that are, you know, part of the community to relate to. You know, I myself, you know, it's really nice to see that, you know, Charlie herself is a queer character. That is just so lovely. And yeah, I think it's fantastic.
Obviously, with anime, you've been moving into voice acting and not just singing, but the voices as well. Can you talk about some of the great stuff you've got a chance to do and how you made that move from being a British voice actor to now working alongside some of the biggest names in the industry on some great shows?
Yeah, it's crazy. I'm really just absolutely so grateful because anime is quite a closed sort of, you know, hard thing to break into. And I've been lucky enough to be receiving auditions from some rosters, which eventually would send me anime auditions, and was just lucky enough to get some roles, you know, like especially with there's an anime called Last Dungeon Boonies that I was in, and I shared a scene with Erica Schroeder, who was like the voice of, I think it was it Luffy in like the Four Kids dub of One Piece, I think. I don't know, I'm so sorry if I got that wrong, but I used to like watch her on TV when like I was younger, and just to be like part of an anime that she was in, let alone share a scene with her, was just such an amazing, like mind-blowing, you know, kind of like started from the bottom, now we're here kind of moment. And yeah, just all of that kind of thing I just absolutely love. Like, it's just crazy to be a part of that world in any way, because we all love anime so much, and to give voices to some characters is just amazing.
I'm curious, was there a certain irony that you enjoyed being someone starting out in the anime industry of voicing a character in a show literally called What If a Kid from the Last Dungeon Boonies Moved to a Starter Town?
Yeah, I have to say, when I saw the title, when I got the audition sides, it was really funny because I was just like, are you kidding? Like, some of these anime titles are absolutely nuts, but it was... Yeah, it's just awesome to be part of it. You know, no matter what the name is, it's just, I'm just really grateful to be in any anime ever. So yeah, and that was a really fun one to do. It's a really sweet show. So yeah, despite the name.
And you also worked on Moriarty the Patriot, playing Mary in that as well. Can you talk a little bit about that?
Yeah, so I voiced Mary Morstan in Moriarty the Patriot, which was a smaller role, but it was, she has quite a substantial role over a couple of episodes, which was amazing to be a part of. And the fact that it's, you know, set in England, obviously, because it's like Sherlock Holmes, and to voice a character with my own British accent was really nice. And I honestly never thought that would ever happen in my life. I thought I'd be American, you know, all the time, doing my American accent. So to do like a British character in an anime based on an iconic British character was really, really cool. I feel like anime has always had its secret fans. It's just that, you know, with geek fandoms, you know, now in the recent years, but absolutely exploding in popularity, it's those people feel like they can now kind of celebrate their love of such an amazing medium. And anime has always been spread over so many different genres. You know, there's an anime of everything, you know, and it's just amazing. Like, there's always something for everybody. And the dedication that the animators put in and everybody who works on an anime is just absolutely amazing. And it's really cool to appreciate that. And I've been an anime fan since I was little. You know, it's just really lovely to share that world with so many people at conventions like this. You know, just to see everybody loving what they love and not being ashamed of it is wonderful.
And apart from the series you've been involved with, are there any particular anime series that you are yourself a fan of or currently watching, anything like that?
Oh man, I absolutely, back in the day, I loved, you know, like Ouran High School Host Club. I loved the obvious ones like Pokemon, and I loved some of these 90s animes that are a bit naughty, like Ninja Scroll. And I also love the Daft Punk music video that they did like in 2001, Interstellar 5555, which is that's kind of got me into anime in the first place. I mean, there's so many that I love. I've watched The Promised Neverland a while back. I'm watching Beastars at the moment. There's so many that I need to watch. It's like really difficult to keep up with them all. I mean, I haven't even like covered most of the ones I've seen, but yeah, I've been an anime fan for a long time, and I need to get back into it. Live action shows kind of took over anime for me, so I definitely got to watch more of them. It was amazing to be part of Puppy Playtime because it was a game that had such an interesting concept, which kind of blew up in such a short amount of time. And when they were making the second chapter, they messaged me, which kind of blew my mind a little bit. And they were like, can you do an audition? So I was like, oh God, of course. Yeah. Really hoping that I got the part because I knew like how loved it was. And we tried 3 different variations of the voice. Obviously, the one we ended up with is the one that they chose. And yeah, that's just been amazing. Like, it's a really cool game with really interesting ideas. I absolutely love Mommy Long Legs as a character. She's just, for me, I mean, it's a kind of the dream role as an actor, like to do a really fun evil character like that with so many different, you know, dynamic emotions that she does. You know, she goes from being happy, you know, sort of comforting, to crazy and, you know, psycho. It's just really fun to perform. But yeah, I'm super happy to be part of that franchise, and they've been great to me, and it's been wonderful to meet the fans of it as well. It's so funny when you get kids who come up to me and they're like, I love Puppy Playtime, and I'm like, who's letting you play it? It's a horror game. But yeah, no, it's amazing. I've had so many, you know, sweet fans come up to me like saying how much they love the voice, and a lovely reception online, and it's amazing. It's been really incredible.
One question you must get quite a lot is whether or not you have any advice for people who'd like to follow in your footsteps. Do you have stock words of wisdom that you distribute at those times?
Yeah, I mean, voiceover is interesting because there's no definitive way to get into it. Every journey is unique, every story is your own, and however you land in it, the most important thing is that you remember that at the end of the day, it is a job, it's not just doing silly voices, so it's very important to be professional. Acting is at the very core of it, it's voice acting, so acting is the most important thing. It doesn't matter how many voices you can do or anything like that, as long as you can act and give life to your character, then that's what matters the most. But yeah, I mean, if there's ever anybody who wants to get into it, you're always welcome to like message me, and I can guide you in some very useful resources. You know, I understand what it was like to start from nothing, and I had people who helped me along the way that I'm really grateful for. So yeah, if you're thinking about doing it, then go for it, you know.
I mean, those are obviously all the do's. I'm curious, are there any particular don'ts that you would flag for people, or common mistakes that people make when they're trying to start becoming voice actors?
Yeah, I mean, for an industry that is primarily based around networking, it is extremely important that if you have any horrible opinions, or if you feel like being mean about anybody, don't. Because I promise you that even if you say something years down the line, it can be used against you, and nobody wants to work with you. You know, like, the word spreads fast. And it's like, if you were in an office and you said something mean about a colleague and they were like, well, that person just called me that or whatever, and it spreads throughout the office, you know, they're going to complain about you. And it's exactly the same with voiceover. Like, you know, word travels quickly. Just be a nice person. You know, you should be a nice person in life anyway. But especially, you know, if you're doing a job. And, you know, so many voice actors are just such amazing people. You know, there's no reason to be horrible about things. Or, you know, just be a nice person. Just don't be a horrible person, full stop. And that will get you far. If you're nice to work with, you're professional, you're on time, you know, it can't go wrong. I've definitely got loads of stuff on the way. I'm recording for quite a popular game next week. I've play the main character in a fantasy RPG that's coming out probably sometime next year, which is amazing. Going to a studio literally on Monday after this to record for a couple of projects. Yeah, I'm just really, really grateful to be working and doing what I want to do, you know. So there's definitely stuff coming. I'm going to be doing more stuff on my YouTube channel as well. So I'm hoping to get more into the singing as well lately. So yeah, just lots going to happen. Watch this space.
I have a message for all the Hazbin fans out there, people who obviously continue to love, celebrate, and enjoy the pilot and are excited about the new series.
Yeah, I barely have any words other than thank you so much for being such incredible fans of something that had so much love go into it. You know, we're so happy that you still celebrate it and appreciate it and love the characters and love the work that we've done. It literally means everything to us. So, yeah, I barely even know what to say without, like, getting emotional. Like, I've just had so many amazing times. Fans have just been the most lovely people ever. I'm so, so grateful for everything.
Just very quickly, I think obviously fans have been talking about the redesigns and sharing their excitement about that. How did you feel about the glow up or the touch up that some of the characters have had?
No, I think the redesigns are wonderful. Like, they look absolutely amazing, and I'm so excited to see where it goes. Like, I'm really interested. You know, I remember, like, when we went to the premiere back in LA years ago and the pilot ended, and I remember just thinking, like, this is going to go, you know, this is going to go far. It's going to be amazing. So, like, whether I'm along for the journey or not, I'm very excited to support it and see where it goes. And it's going to be an amazing series. I can feel it.